right, so if you look through Twitter far enough, you'll see the moment where I'm out for my morning walk, as I always do, and I'm listening to Simple Life Together, and I had to stop, grab my iPhone, fire up Tweetbot, and post about this conference that they were talking about called SimpleREV. And I knew right away that when he was talking about it, I had to be there. And part of the reason why is because I'd never been to Minnesota, and that's actually enough reason for me to go. But the other part is that our simplification journey, my wife and my family and I, actually led to the creation of my website, DocumentSnap. And what happened was, so when we got engaged, my wife and I, we did what you're supposed to do. We decided we were going to buy a house. And I actually moved in with my in-laws and lived there for 2 years, which I could do a total separate talk on that. So, you know, we lived there, we saved up money, and we bought this really big 100-year-old character home. Fantastic. What we learned over the years after having a couple kids and spending every single weekend at Home Depot and, you know, dealing with tenants and all that sort of stuff, which you have to do in Vancouver, is we are just not 100-year-old character home people. You know, some people like that stuff. We are not one of those people. And, you know, just with careers and kids and everything, we were doing all this stuff that we actually didn't even enjoy doing. So what we decided to do is we sold our home and we moved from this large 100-year-old character home to this much smaller townhouse. And we were like, great, you know, all this stuff is taken care of for us. We can focus on the things that we enjoy. We actually simplified a little too much. What I didn't realize is Vancouver is in Canada, but it only snows about 2 days a year. And I just thought, oh, we're living in a townhouse. People take care of everything. But what happens is, what I didn't realize is you actually have to shovel, you know, your stairs and in front of your place. But I had simplified so much, I'd gotten rid of all our tools and stuff like that, gotten rid of our shovels. So our first winter there, I was out with my toddler's plastic hockey stick, scraping all the snow off the stairs, which is, you know, pretty much the most Canadian thing you could possibly do. And so, yeah, so we're moving and we're packing up and everything, and I have this big bulging file cabinet with paper all over the place. And as I was moving, and you know, some of this paper I had moved, you know, kept moved from, you know, 5 moves ago, and I'm just like, this is ridiculous. All this paper I don't need. I don't know why I'm keeping it. It's taking up too much space. I have to carry it, which I try to avoid when possible. And so I said, I'm going to go paperless, not really knowing what that meant. And if I was like a normal, well-adjusted person, I probably would have just gone to Best Buy and bought a scanner and gotten on with my life. But of course, I have to find, you know, the most efficient, the most automated, you know, the most awesome way to go paperless possible. And so, I'm looking through all this stuff, and you know, there's some blog posts by Merlin Mann on 43 folders here, and then some articles here. But there wasn't any one place that had all the information that I was looking for. So I kind of decided to start it myself, and that's how DocumentSnap was born. And who here runs a blog or an email newsletter or a podcast or something like that? Yeah. Well, one of my favorite parts about that is hearing from readers and hearing their stories about how they go paperless, which I hear quite a bit. And I received one of my favorites is this email I received from a woman named Sue. And Sue and her husband had been married for 50 years, that's 50. And, you know, throughout their entire marriage, you know, she did her thing and her husband was the one responsible for all, you know, the finances and the record keeping and all that stuff. And that was fine, you know, that's just how their life was. But then, unfortunately, her husband was diagnosed with lung cancer and went downhill quite quickly. And so Sue was the one that was kind of thrown into managing all this stuff. So, you know, she's dealing with everything that goes along with that. But then she found, then of course tax time came. And so she's scrambling, trying to find, you know, where is everything? What, you know, how do I even do taxes? You know, she had never done anything like that before. And so she wrote me, and this is in her words, she said, you know, it occurred to me that you don't have to be smart to use TurboTax. I bet some pretty stupid people use TurboTax just fine. That's her words, not mine. And so, you know, she got it done. She got through her taxes, you know, got all that done. And then she said, if I'm going to be the one that's responsible for dealing with this stuff from now on, I'm going to do things in a much more organized fashion. So she started doing things like their finances, keeping it in Excel instead of the old ledger books that her husband had always used. And she decided that she was going to go paperless. And so she started, you know, she got a scanner and some software, and that's kind of how we got in contact. And so she wrote me and she said, you know, what surprised me about this whole process is that it's actually fun, you know, going from panic to fun, you know, who would have thought it? And I really like that because, you know, we hear about, you know, technological solutions a lot of time, and we think it's for, you know, some certain segment of the population. It's for young people or for techies or, you know, whatever. But, you know, anybody can do stuff with technology. You just have to know the best way to do it and the simplest way to do it. And so I'm going to talk about going paperless. And usually when you hear about going paperless, you know, it's usually about going green, or it's about, you know, having a clean desk. Or, you know, a lot of my readers, you know, live in RVs. I have a lot of readers who live in RVs and small homes, and, you know, by necessity, they just don't have the space for a lot of paper. So they go paperless. For me, all of that stuff is really, really great. But for me, the main benefit of going paperless is just basically being able to have access to the information that you need right when you need it, wherever you need it. And just not having to think about where things are and not having to have clutter weighing down your mind. It's out of the way, but when you need information, it's there for you to actually do something with. And so I'm going to talk about going paperless, and I'm going to talk about it from three main perspectives. The first is how to eliminate paper if that's something you want to do. The second is how to design a paperless workflow that's simple and works for you. And then the third is how to protect your electronic information, how to keep it safe. And, you know, this is going to sound weird given what I do and, you know, even the title of this talk, but I'm actually not a big fan of the word paperless. And usually when I meet people and tell them what I do, half the time I just say computer stuff because I don't feel like getting into it. But if the P word does come up, I basically get one of two reactions. The first is people will say, oh, me too, man, that's awesome. You know, check out these apps I use. You know, I'm totally paper, I hate paper. So that's one reaction, not super common. The other reaction is people will kind of look at me and they'll kind of look up and down me. You know, what's this guy trying to sell me? And they'll say, they'll always ask me some variation on this question. Do you think it's possible to go totally paperless? And I can tell their entire opinion of me as a person basically weighs on how I answer that question. So part of the reason I don't like the word paperless is it almost creates this false sense of this ideal state that if you haven't gotten rid of all of your paper, you're somehow not successful at your paperless project. The other reaction to it is that it almost creates this dividing state. Like people will say, oh, I could never go paperless because I need to print stuff out and, you know, write on it to focus. Or I could never go paperless because, you know, I just like writing in my notebook. That works for me. I'm like, or, you know, I can never go paperless because I just love reading paper books, right? To me, it's not about that. To me, going paperless is not about taking things away that work for you. I was listening to this podcast once called In Beta, and the hosts at the time, Kevin Purdy and Gina Trapani, were talking about this. And I really liked the way that Kevin put it. He said, when you're pledging to go paperless, what you're pledging to do is not to create more paper for your other people or yourself than you need to. And I would add to that and say you're also pledging not to keep more paper than you need to. So it's not about getting rid of all the paper. It's just about being more mindful about the paper that you use and the paper that you keep, and make sure that the stuff that you're holding on to is actually doing something for you. That's how I look at it. Now, I'm going to be talking about mentioning, you know, some products and referencing some blog posts and resources. So what I've done is I've put together this resource page for you, so you don't have to go crazy, you know, writing down URLs and stuff like that. That should be live now, I hope. And that will stay up. It's not like a limited time thing. And everything I talk about will be linked to on that page. And I'll repeat it at the end, too. So if you miss it, I will repeat it at the end. So let's get into how you eliminate paper, with the assumption that you have some, at least, that you want to eliminate. How do you do that? For me, the first step is to start with the goal. So, you know, where are you now, and where are you actually looking to get to? What are you actually trying to do with this project? Because a lot of times we just start making changes, but we don't actually know what it is we're trying to do. So for me, that's really important. The second step is to examine your paper. You know, what paper are you actually using? What paper are you holding on to? Where is paper coming into your life? And I'm going to talk about that in a second. The third is to start small. You don't have to make these big changes all at once. You can change one small piece and, you know, get some success, get your feet wet, and then kind of iterate from there. And then finally, what you want to do is, once you get up and running, you want to periodically review what you're doing. You know, is what you're doing still working? Is there maybe some more efficient ways? Are there some steps you can cut out? So you want to do that from time to time. So I start this blog. It's all about going paperless, and I'm writing all these blog posts about, you know, whatever, backup and scanning and all that stuff and all these nerdy topics. And then I start getting these emails, and it'll say things like, "Hey, Brooks, you know, I really want to go paperless, but my husband's not on board. What do I do?" Or, you know, "Hey, Brooks, I'm totally paperless, but, you know, my wife has paper everywhere. You know, how can I convince her?" And I'm just like, oh, my gosh, you know, here I am writing all these nerdy topics, and all of a sudden I'm doing marriage counseling. And, you know, my wife will tell you I'm not the best person to be doing marriage counseling. I'll just say that. So, you know, my approach to this is, and actually it was funny, on the plane here I was listening to the SimpleREV podcast where you guys were, Cheryl and Dave were talking about some of this with Joel and Dan. And for me, it's about, as much as possible, see if you can kind of seed the idea early and see if you can make it partly their idea so they feel ownership in this. You know, just instead of saying, "Hey, we need to do this," and you need to do this, see if you can kind of start small and get them on board with some quick wins. And, you know, show some successes. Don't tell what you're going to do. You know, show how, you know, it's okay if this hard drive, if these files get deleted, show how you can get them back easily and stuff like that. Don't just, you can never convince somebody of something. It's much easier to show rather than tell. That works for me. Then again, last week my wife printed out a paper calendar and stuck it on front of our fridge, so maybe I'm not the best person to be giving advice on this. Very stressful. All right, so I was saying that one thing you want to do is look at the sources of paper. You know, where do you have paper actually coming into your life? And, you know, if you're like me, you've got paper coming in all over the place. You got paper coming in from mail, paper coming in from family. You know, my kids' backpacks are just a never-ending source of paper from school. You know, you've got receipts. You've got self-inflicted paper. You know, stuff that you're printing out, stuff you're printing out yourself. Anyone who works in an office has probably seen that tray beside the printer where people print stuff out but never actually come pick it up. You know, you've got catalogs and stuff like that. It can be a really helpful exercise to just sit down and, like, think of, where is all this paper coming from? Because then you can look at this list and see a lot of it, hey, you know, I can just eliminate that altogether. Like, this is information coming into my life that I don't even need, so I'm just going to cut it out. Some of it will be stuff that, you know, maybe it will make sense to shift to digital format if possible. And some of it makes sense to keep in paper, so, you know, keep doing it that way. So I have a little activity for you. what I want you to do is for the next, say, 30 seconds or something like that, just think as much as you can, what are the sources of paper that you have coming in? I myself am a massive introvert, so I don't like it when I'm told to talk to the people beside me. If you want to talk to the people around you, that's totally cool. If you want to be like Sherlock and go into your mind palace and do it, you know, that's cool too. So I'm going to give you like 30 seconds and just think, where is the paper coming into your life? All right, you can continue this exercise later, but we'll keep moving. By the way, when you're the one standing up here, 30 seconds is a really long time. Just, you know. All right, so you've cut out some paper at least, if that makes sense to you. The next thing you want to do is you want to think of your paperless workflow. What you don't want to do is just jump in and start implementing stuff. You want to kind of think about, give some thought to, you know, where is the physical paper coming in? Where does it go when it comes in? How are you scanning it? You know, where are those electronic documents going? And what you want to do is you kind of want to sketch that out in whatever way that makes sense to you. Some people like flowcharts, some people like mind maps, you know, whatever works for you. Because if you kind of think it out and sketch it out first, then you're just plugging solutions into that process. You're not trying to figure out everything as you go along. It's much, much easier. When you think about going paperless, of course, and you're thinking about your paperless workflow, you know, we talk about capturing paper. How do we take paper and make it digital, make it electronic? And the most obvious way, you can see it right there on the screen, is a scanner, of course. What a lot of people will do is, you know, they'll use the flatbed scanner that they bought for photos. They'll use the scanner that comes with your all-in-one.
Yes.
You know, that it's not that you can't do that. You absolutely can, and it's not like you have to go out and buy some special product to go paperless. I will say, though, that if you have a lot of paper to deal with on a regular basis, or you have a big backlog, it may make sense for you to pick up an actual document scanner. There's scanners that specialize in this stuff and make things much, much easier and simpler than trying to do it with a tool that's just not really made for the job. Lots of different types of scanners out there. If you have a reasonable volume of paper to deal with, it may make sense to pick up a scanner with what's called an automated document feeder. So instead of feeding paper in one by one and driving yourself crazy, you can just take a stack of paper, put it in, and go. It can also be very helpful to have a scanner that scans duplex, which means it scans both sides of the page at once. Again, none of this is slam dunk required, but it will just make things much faster and much easier. Lots of different types of scanners out there. The one you see there on the screen on the left is called the Neat. They have different models. The Neat Receipt is a small portable one. It's okay. Neat Desk is a desktop model that's quite popular. The one you see that up there on the screen is called the Neat Connect. And one cool thing about that is it will scan directly to the cloud. You don't have to scan to a computer or anything like that. You can upload it right to Evernote or Dropbox without having a computer involved, which is kind of cool. The type of scanners I personally use is called the ScanSnap by Fujitsu. ScanSnap fans in the house, sorry. I bet I'm the only person who gets woohoos when I mention scanners. It's not the first time it's happened, either. So I personally use the ScanSnap. It's a pretty good device. There's different models. The one you see up there on the screen is called the iX500. You don't have to go crazy. All of these are linked to on the resource page, which is a really fast kind of desktop scanner. A smaller version of that is called the S1300i. And one thing I like about that one, especially for home use or a lot of people in RVs and small spaces use that one, is because it's small, it's like that size by that size, but it has a 10-sheet document feeder and scans both sides. So you get that good balance of size and speed, basically. They also, just last week, released a smaller version, like a mobile version, called the iX100. and that's a wireless scanner. So it will scan wirelessly to a computer or mobile device. So you, and if you don't have a Wi-Fi network, it will actually create one for you. So you can scan wherever you are. Again, none of this is super required, but can be helpful. When we think about capturing paper, though, you know, the first thing we think of is a scanner, but nowadays the cameras in our smartphones are getting so good and the apps are getting so good that our smartphones and tablets actually make pretty good document scanners. You may not want to scan a 20-page document with your phone, you could, but for capturing, you know, one-off documents, capturing receipts, smartphones actually do a really good job. Lots of different apps out there. Evernote has a document scanner built in, and I think just yesterday or the day before, they for some reason released a new scanning app. I haven't tried it yet. Scanner Pro is a really good app for iOS. ScanBot is a good one for iOS and Android, and it will do it'll make documents searchable as well. And Genius Scan is a really good one for iOS, Android, and Windows Phone. And again, all those are linked to on the resource page. You can check them out. Some of them are free, some of them are a couple bucks. So I want to do another activity, and this is, we'll do a shorter one this time, 20 seconds, let's say. And 30 seconds is a little long. And so this is kind of a weird question, how will you scan? Like, I bet you've never been asked that in your entire life before. The reason I ask that question is because a lot of times what you do to capture paper really depends on the context that you're going to be doing it in. So what I mean by that is, do you want a desktop scanner that's going to be sitting on your desk? Do you want something that you can throw in a drawer? Do you need something that you want to carry around with you, maybe to see clients, or, you know, just carry around in a bag? Or can you just manage with your smartphone? What you do with capturing paper is really informed by how the ways that you're actually going to be scanning. So I'll give you just like 20 seconds or 15 seconds, let's say, just to think about in what situations might you need to capture a paper. All right, I think we're good there. So I've had enough. Can't stand. I have two kids. I can't stand to handle silence. Two boys. So you're going to have an opportunity to bring this all together later, but it's just something that can be really helpful to think about. Now what happens is, and I kind of referenced this earlier, is a lot of times we think, I'm going to go paperless. And so we buy a scanner and we start scanning our documents and then, oh no, you know, where the heck is everything? Right? We've scanned all this stuff but we can't find any of it. And I received an email from one of my readers one time, his name's John Yeager, and I love the way that he put it. He said, you know, Brooks, going paperless sounds great, but I don't want to trade a physical paper mess for a digital mess. And when I read that, I'm like, yes, that perfectly describes the problem, right? Because at least when you have a paper mess, you can tell you have a problem. When you have a digital mess, a lot of times you don't even realize you have a problem, you know, until you have a problem, right? Until you're looking for something and you just can't find it. So by far the biggest question I get on Document Snap is around organization. How do I organize my electronic documents? And for me, when I think about organizing electronic documents, it really comes down to two main things: having a consistent and descriptive naming convention, and having some sort of folder or organization structure that works for you. And I want to talk about naming convention first, because it's one of those things that a lot of times we don't really think about. But I can tell you that having a consistent and descriptive naming convention is the biggest thing that you can do to be able to find these documents later, right? Because we're saving these documents so that we can find them later. So how do you name your documents? A friend of mine, a guy named Brett Kelly, I think some of you probably know, he writes an ebook called Evernote Essentials, and his website is nerdgap.com, which is a fantastic name. And I was at the very first Evernote conference back in 2011. Dan was there too. And Brett was giving a talk, and he was talking about naming Evernote notes, but I would apply this to any type of electronic document. And what he says is, what you want to do is you want to think of your future you when you're naming it. Actually, he says dumb future you, but, you know, I'm Canadian, so we'll just say future you. And so what we mean by that is, you know, when you're scanning this document and saving it, you know what it is because you're the one saving it, right? But what about if you're looking for it in a year, in 2 years, in 5 years? Are you going to be able to find it again? And so what we recommend is when you're saving this document, what you want to do is think about what are some words that I might use to look for this document in the future and, you know, work them into the name now in a way that makes sense. I also recommend putting the date in the file name. A lot of people will say, you know, why do you need to bother with that? Because, you know, computers have create date and modify dates, but those can very easily become messed up. And if you have the date in the file name, you can see at a glance, you know, when that document's for. They'll be nicely, I like putting it at the beginning of the file name so that when you're looking at your files, they're all nicely sorted by date. Some people like putting it at the end. You know, there's no right or wrong way to do it, as long as you do it in a consistent fashion. So let's say we have a document and it's a Comcast bill, let's say. So maybe it's, you know, we'll start with the date, maybe. That's what I would start with. And, you know, it's a Comcast bill. So, you know, using that concept of the future you, what's a word we might want to put in that file name so we can find it later?
Comcast bill.
That is a great idea. Yeah, you probably want to have the word Comcast in there. At least I would. And for you, that might be enough. Like, a lot of my electronic documents are just, you know, date-comcast.pdf. Well, we don't have Comcast in Canada, which I understand is a good thing, but, you know, date-utility.pdf, done. That might be enough for you. Now, if you work with maybe different types of documents for Comcast for whatever reason, you know, maybe you need to specify a bit further. Maybe you'll say Comcast-bill or Comcast-invoice. Maybe you work with clients or with projects. It might make sense to put in, you know, a client code or a project code, something you can use to search on later. Everything you're doing around this is helping you find these documents later. A lot of people get hung up on, should it be Comcast-invoice, Comcast_invoice, Comcast-invoice? I get an unbelievable amount of questions on this. It really doesn't matter. It's 100% personal preference. The key, though, is to be consistent. And I'm going to talk about some tools that will help with that in a minute. Yes?
Do you ever run into issues or anybody contacting you about the length of the name?
No. You know, there is, with operating systems, there is, you know, a length, but it's pretty long now. What I would say, though, is, you want to, if you name it too long, what's going to happen is when you're looking at these files, you know, in your Finder window or Windows Explorer or on your tablet or whatever, you know, a lot of it might get cut off. So you're going to see a lot of date-comc or something. So you want to keep it descriptive, but not verbose, I would say. That's what I would do.
Because I have a backup system that when it transfers files, mm-hmm. it will not transfer.
Ooh. That's, yeah, not ideal. What system is that, just out of curiosity?
What's that?
What system is that, just out of
curiosity? That's SyncBack.
Oh, okay, yeah, that's not ideal. So that's good to know, though. Yeah, I hadn't heard that one. So, you know, maybe bringing together, this might be a file name that you use. The file name you use might be completely different. This stuff, you know, makes sense differently to different people. What you want to do is you want to build it out of your documents. Now, once you know what you're going to name your document, of course, then you need to think about where you're going to save these things. For some of you, it might just be on your Mac or your Windows computer. Other people might want to save it in the cloud, somewhere like Evernote or Box or Dropbox or whatever. Where you save your documents is really a function of, and you want to ask yourself these questions, how secure do I need my documents to be? Am I comfortable having them on the cloud? Some people are not. Some people, they're totally fine with it. For some people, they only need to access it on their computer. For others, they want to have remote access, share it with different people. You need to think about how you're going to be working with these documents and who needs to be working with these documents. And that will help you figure out where you're going to store these things. Now, here's an area where people get very, very hung up, is the folder structure. you know, we all want to have, you know, what's the best folder structure? You know, what's the right folder structure? And it would be awesome if it was possible to just say, here you go. The problem is, you know, we all have different types of documents, different businesses, different stuff going on in our life. And even worse than that, our brains all work differently. So what is like a completely logical folder structure to me will just look ridiculous to you. So, you know, what I usually recommend is as much as possible, have your folder structure kind of built out of the documents that you have. Instead of trying to shoehorn them into some system you find online, just look at, you know, what kind of documents do I have and build some high-level categories out of that. Now, one thing I do see a lot is, and if you have a filing structure that works really well for you with your paper files, a lot of people find it really helpful to transition that to digital, because then it's, you know, one less thing to have to learn. So if you already have a system that works well for you, yeah.
Folder structure question.
Mm-hmm.
Do you happen to know if Evernote is ever going to go to having subfolders? Have you heard anything like that?
I don't know. They have a fake subfolder called Stacks, but it's only one level deep. Some people try to fake it with tags and stuff like that. I wouldn't hold my breath on that, but who knows? I don't know. Yes?
Do you ever consider like taking a document and putting it in multiple folders based on the fact that sometimes your brain works a certain way? Like sometimes I'm looking for something based on the date, but sometimes I might be looking for based on like some, you know.
I don't personally do that. I would recommend not doing that, but we'll talk about some things that might help with those situations. For me, I want my stuff in one place if possible. That's just me, because then it's less to manage. Now, what I see a lot of people do is create these really deep hierarchical folder structures, you know, folder and folder, 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 with, you know, fewer files in each folder. And that's totally cool. If that works for you, of course, you have to do what works for you. For me personally, I recommend a more shallow folder structure, if possible. You know, have less folders with more files in them rather than these really deep hierarchical structures. And this becomes possible when you're using that good, consistent, and descriptive naming convention, and you learn how to look for some documents, which we're going to talk about in a bit. I was reading this article by someone named Denise Amrich. She's a nurse, actually, but she writes about paperless topics for ZDNet. And I like the way that she put it. She said, every time we reduce the number of keystrokes, touch gestures, or seconds it takes to access desired data, we decrease the barriers to paperless. And I'm a big believer in that, because our human brains are amazing. I don't know why I specified human brains, but our brains are, as opposed to those other brains we have, our brains are amazing at finding reasons not to do something. And the more pain in the ass it is to dig through folders to save something and dig through folders to look for something, the more we will just subconsciously find excuses to, you know, go binge watch True Detective or something like that rather than, you know, scan our documents. It's horrible. So you want to make things as simple and easy with as few clicks as possible. And a shallow folder structure helps with that.
Hey, Brooks.
Yes.
Why do we even need folders at all? What about metadata? The data about data and tagging things? Will there ever be a day where we don't need folders?
It's interesting you say that. I was reading this interview with Phil Libin, the CEO of Evernote, one time, and they were actually asking him, how do you organize your data, your Evernote notes? And he said, I just basically dump everything. You know, 99% of my stuff is just dumped into one big notebook. You can definitely do that. Some people do that. For me, I like having a little bit of hierarchy. Just, you know, you were saying stuff like tagging and dates and stuff like that. A folder hierarchy will never change and will never get messed up. Stuff like tags, you know, I like tags. I tag my stuff. It's a point of failure, whereas folders aren't really point of failure. That's for me. But if you want to organize it that way, you know, a lot of people do, actually. So, yeah, absolutely. One thing I do personally recommend that works really well for me is when I'm scanning stuff and saving stuff, I like to save it to a centralized inbox. So one place where everything goes to. This is very common with physical paper. You know, Vanessa, I'm sure you can attest to that. A lot of people don't do it with digital stuff. And it might seem like it's more efficient to, you know, scan a document, name it, and save it. Scan the next document, name it, and save it. It might seem like it's more efficient, but I've actually timed it, and it's actually faster to just scan everything into, you know, get it digitized, and then go through and process it that way. It's simpler and it's faster. But the main reason why I like doing it this way is it opens up the door for some automation. There's some things that our computers can do that makes going paperless much easier and much faster. My favorite tool is something called a text expansion tool.
Yeah.
Is anyone familiar with a text expansion tool? Awesome. Yeah, well, obviously you too. those jokers up there. You just ignore everything I'm going to say for the next 5 minutes. No hand putting up hands.
5 minutes?
Yeah. I cannot wait for your turn. All right, that's why I like going first. So what a text expansion tool is, I won't get into it too much because on the resource page there's a link to a video that shows how this works. But basically, my favorite tool on any platform is called Text Expander, and there's a Windows version called Brevi. There's this sketchnote floating around that my friend Darren Boss made, where I unfortunately said that if I use a computer that doesn't have Text Expander, I crawl up under my desk and cry like a little baby. And he sketched that out, and it's on Twitter now, thankfully. What a text expansion tool does is allow you to define these small snippets of text, and when you type them in, they expand to a larger block of text. So I was saying that I like to put the date in the file name. So what I can do, and this is just a code I made up, every time I, for example, type semicolon DT, it automatically expands to today's date, whatever day it is. If I'm naming like a city MasterCard bill, I just type semicolon CM, and it automatically expands to city_mastercard.pdf. You can even do wacky things like have it do date math, and you can have it, you know, automatically insert the cursor in the middle if you want to type in a project code or something like that. Text expansion tools are awesome anywhere on your computer where you might type in the same bit of text more than once, but they're killer for naming your paperless documents. Now, text expansion tools are great, but what if your computer could actually look at the documents that you're scanning and saving, figure out what they are, and then name it and file them away for you? This is like the holy grail of going paperless, right? Our computer doing all this crap for us so we don't have to do it. And this is actually possible. On the Mac, there's a tool called Hazel, and on Windows, there's a tool called File Juggler that I begged the developer to add this feature to, and he actually did. So what these will allow you to do, it's kind of like Text Expander, where these tools can do a million things, but I'm just going to talk about it in relation to going paperless. So what you could do is you could say, because remember, we're scanning everything to that central inbox. So we can say, hey, Hazel or File Juggler, I want you to watch my inbox folder for me. If you see a PDF document and look inside the text, if you see that this PDF document has, you know, the words National Grid, pay this amount, and account number 99999, chances are that's my monthly National Grid bill. And I also want you to take a look at the date, make a note of that as well. And so what that will do is it will watch that inbox folder. If it sees a document that matches that, it will give it our consistent and descriptive naming convention, and it will file it away for us to the folder where it needs to go. These tools are awesome for many reasons. One of them is speed. You know, the less we have to do, the better. It takes a lot of the heavy lifting out of going paperless. But for me, the bigger reason is it helps enforce consistency. We don't have to go back and look at, you know, what we named our Comcast bill last month to be consistent. It's going to do it for us every time. So these automation tools are huge. I find them very helpful anyway. Now, one thing, though, I find interesting about going paperless is that, you know, we will we'll digitize our documents, we'll organize all our documents, do all that stuff, but when it comes to actually looking for our documents, you know, we have a document we want to find, we basically do it the digital equivalent of the way we've always done it since, you know, I was a kid. You know, you go, you find the digital equivalent of the folder, or sorry, the drawer, you open it up, you leaf through and find the folder that you're looking for, you open it up, you leaf through the documents to find the one that you're looking for. And, you know, if that works for you, awesome, you know, keep on doing it. But for me, one of the biggest benefits of going paperless is around learning how to search for documents, how to find the document that you need right when you need it. And we're lucky right now, actually, that pretty much all the platforms that we use to store these documents, whether it's our Mac, whether it's Windows, Evernote, you know, whatever, all have the ability to search for documents, not just by the name of the document, but the actual words that are inside the document. The problem is, though, we hear this and we think, okay, I'm going to try it. So, you know, we click on that search box and we type something in and we just get a bunch of junk back. You know, and, you know, instead of sifting through all this stuff, I might as well just go to my folders the way that our forefathers did. But a lot of times there's these very simple things we can do when we're searching, you know, like little simple tweaks when we're typing stuff in that will allow us just to zoom right in on the document that we're looking for right when we need it. The key, of course, is learning how to do that. So what I've done is on the resource page, I've pulled a chapter out of one of my books, or guides, I guess you'd call it, and just linked to it on the resource page, and you guys can just download that for free. I recommend sometime when you have a couple minutes, just go through, and it takes you through how to search for documents on the Mac, how to search for documents on Windows, and just try it out, and just learn these little things you can do to really zoom in and find the file that you're looking for. Because when you start bringing this stuff together, when you start having that consistent and descriptive naming convention, and your documents are searchable by the text, and you know you learn how the search works on your platform, you just become like a paperless ninja. You can just like zoom, like anything that you're looking for is just there, right where you need it. I find that really, really huge. I actually managed to impress my wife the other day by actually instantly bringing back something. Our kids go through shoes like crazy, and she was complaining about, you know, how long do these shoes last? And I just said, well, let me see. So I just typed in DC shoes, and it just went right to the MasterCard bill when we bought it. And she said, whoa. And impressing my wife with technology is almost impossible. So, yeah, sorry, question.
I can see how this is great moving forward. Mm-hmm. What I do with the 30 years of documents, I read, this was a strategy for getting them in.
Yeah.
Could you drag those into the file and have the Hazel?
Okay. Sure. Where Hazel works the best is for documents that are recurring. So if you have, you know, years worth of whatever, MasterCard bills, let's just say, what you could do is set up that Hazel rule, have it watch for the date, and then, yeah, it'll just chug through and should, hopefully, do it all for you. So, yeah. Yeah, definitely.
But something like that, you're going to need your OCR already in place, or it's going to need to be, I mean, if it's a JPEG, it's not going to be able to search it, correct?
If it's a JPEG, yeah. Right. You would need to run it through some sort of OCR tool, yes, absolutely.
If you don't do it in Evernote.
Yeah, exactly. OCR, exactly right, yeah.
Optical character recognition?
Yes.
OCR?
Yes. Yes.
Thank you,
John. There actually is, I forgot to mention, there actually is on the resource page, there's a link to a video that actually says, you know, what is OCR and how does it work. So I forgot to mention that. So thank you for bringing that up.
We've been talking about examples of like recurring payments for credit card bills, utility bills, things like that. I mm-hmm. assume these are just examples and you would advocate going paperless in those areas where possible.
I personally do, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, for sure. Anything you can make digital first, that you want to make digital first, just is less work later, for sure. So you had a question?
I have a question, and I don't know if anybody in here is like a U.S. tax accountant, but my understanding is that, like, my accountant has me keeping all my records on paper because the IRS requires it,
right.
Which is a pain in the ass because I was pretty paperless before I went into business, and now I actually own a laser printer and I print everything out that was formerly digital. And I was just curious if you,
well,
you know,
my,
if, you know, what you kind of advocate for that.
So, yeah, I am not a U.S. tax accountant. Yeah. In fact, I'm not even American. But my under
figure out a way to do
so.
This
so yeah. Normally, I would say talk to your accountant, but it sounds like you already did that.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
I'm
go.
In.
Yeah.
Generally, you can scan it. A lot of companies are starting to do digital receipts because the problem is the receipts start wearing out after about 3 years. Sometimes faster. Sometimes they feel like they have to have a hard copy, but all they do is scan it and put it in their files.
Yeah,
my understanding actually is the IRS is actually quite advanced in this area, mm-hmm. Much more so than up in Canada. And there's a, what's it called? Procedure 97-22 or something like that. That now, that is the first time I've ever gotten a file. My understanding is that if you reference that, that is what most of these vendors use to say that you can have electronic documents, and that kind of takes you through the requirements. It needs to be organized. It needs to be, you need to be able to produce, you know, the information that you need.
Right.
Definitely, you should not need to print out something that starts digital.
Right.
In Canada, our rule is that it has to stay for a certain number of years in the original format that it is. So if it starts digital, it can be digital. If it starts paper, you need to hang on to the paper. My understanding is in the United States it's not that way, but definitely do not listen to the Canadian. Yeah.
I have a question about that. I am Canadian, so I've benefited of the four other Canadians.
Yeah.
I did have to provide the Canada Revenue Agency last year with some charitable donation receipts. And for the first time ever, in the letter they mailed me, they said, you can now scan these documents and send them to us. So that's what I did. And then I was like, well, could I have just scanned these and thrown the originals out? Or if they're allowing me to submit them this way?
Yeah, and the worst part is it even depends on who you talk to at the CRA. Not to bore 97% of this room, but yeah, anyway, we can take that offline. But yeah.
Could you talk about photos and file sizes? For me, I get really confused with JPEGs, TIFFs, PDFs. Like there's five different ways
right.
that you can save something, and that's if you want it. The original size, big, medium, small, how do you want to save this? And when I started taking pictures of these documents,
right.
I would try to put it into the software that I have online. It's like, oh, that's too big. I'm like, it's just a bill. What do you mean the picture's too big? And
right.
I have to go back and try to do it again. If you could talk about that.
Sure. Do I have time to talk about that?
No.
Am I going to get the hook? Okay. So I generally recommend if you're capturing electronic documents, PDF is generally the best and most future-proof way to do that. It can be made searchable. And generally, it can be smaller than a JPEG. Now, taking a picture with your phone will definitely work. I would actually recommend using one of those apps that I referenced earlier, and that will use your phone's camera to do it. It will optimize it. It will get rid of, you know, the table behind your picture, your receipt, and it will just clean up the image and it will make it smaller. So I would recommend going that way. You'll find a much better experience using, even if you used Evernote, I don't know if you do, but even using the Evernote document camera or something like that, or one of those scanning apps links to on the resource page. I don't know why I keep pointing back there. You'll have a better experience that way, for sure.
Nice to meet you. I realize you don't probably have time to answer this, so you probably have it already written up somewhere. If you can just point me to it. What do you do as far as when you already have it all digital, but it's coming to you in an email, and you want to sync it with the stuff, you know, the file folder that you have on your desk?
Mm. Different ways to do it. Some people use software that can read, you know, you can drag stuff, you know, messages in from Outlook or whatever. What I personally do, I just save the attachments to that inbox I was talking about earlier. That's what I personally do. Or if it's something, you know, an Amazon receipt, for example, what I will do is I will save that as a PDF into my my inbox. That's what I personally do.
Or email it to your Evernote account.
Or email it to your Evernote account, correct, okay. Yeah.
I was also going to suggest if you are saving hard copies or PDF copies to the desktop, you can use IFTT.
Yeah.
Just then that. You can set up a recipe that would take any PDF attachment and save it
absolutely.
To your Dropbox.
Yeah,
and then
absolutely.
End up on your computer.
Yeah, good tip. Mm-hmm. Awesome. All right, so for me, the most important part of going paperless is not how you scan your documents. It's not how you organize your documents. It's not how you look for your documents. For me, the most important part of going paperless is making sure your documents are protected. I was walking home from my son's school the other day, and there was this poster up everywhere. And I don't know if you can read it, but basically a teacher's laptop was stolen from the school, which is nice to hear. And it had her, or him, master's coursework on it. And the interesting part to me was at the bottom, it said, you know, large cash reward for the safe return of the information on the computer. They don't care about the computer. They want that information back. The physical stuff doesn't matter, but when something electronic is gone, it's gone. And when we're talking about going paperless, you basically have to operate on the assumption that all your stuff is about to disappear, because that could absolutely happen. It's even happened to me. The key for me, though, it was a complete non-event. All my documents disappeared. It's a long story that I can tell later. All my documents disappeared, but in 30 seconds, I had them all back, because it was a non-event for me. And you know, there's that cliche, there's two types of hard drives, those that have crashed and those that will crash. We always hear we need to back up our computer. You know, it's like you need to eat your vegetables. Everybody says it, right? When you're going paperless, it is absolutely not optional. You have to have a backup. I personally recommend having at least two backups. I have four, just because I'm one of those people, but backups is one area where the more the merrier, for sure. You want to have it automated if possible. I personally recommend having at least a local backup, so that could be an external hard drive plugged in your computer. Both Mac and Windows have backup software built in, so you don't have to go and buy some fancy software from Staples or whatever. You know, it's all built in. Just need to plug it in and go. And at least one offsite location. For me, I use online backup. I use one called Crash Plan. Backblaze.
Yeah,
yeah, Crash Plan. Backblaze is another good one. Any woos for Backblaze?
Yes, woo for
Backblaze. Okay, there you go. Backblaze. you know, on the resource page, I have a link to a video that kind of takes you through different types of backups and how it all works. So you can check that out if you're interested. I have a friend who is not comfortable having his information backed up to the cloud. So what we do is we have a hard drive at each other's house and backup encrypted to that. There's a link to a blog post on the resource page that shows how that all works. The key, though, is, you know, we talked about a bunch of stuff around going paperless. As you can see, there's a lot of ways you can go. There's a lot of things you can do. What happens to a lot of us is, there's so much information online about going paperless, and I'm incredibly guilty of creating much of it. So we get into analysis paralysis. You know, we just read, but we don't actually take action. I used to have this course called the Paperless Action Plan. Somebody helpfully pointed out that selling a course with the acronym PAP is not the best marketing tool. So let's just call it the Paperless Plan of Action. Let's call it that. So what I would like you to do, not now, but you know, going forward, on the bottom of that resource page is a link to two files. One is a Word document, one is a PDF if you need to print it out and write, just don't tell me about it. And it will basically help you craft a plan of action. It'll help you, you know, go through thinking about what it is that you actually want to do, so you can plug in those steps. And it will bring together some of the activities we've done today. This stuff does not have to be complicated. It really doesn't. You can start with whatever capture method you have, whether it's your smartphone or whatever scanner you have. Just create a really simple high-level folder structure. Make sure everything's backed up. and just start scanning. The good thing about digital is that everything can be improved and iterated on later. I'm welcome to have any questions you have, although we've hit a lot of them. You first.
Do you have any recommendations on external drives? I've had two Western Digitals that have had massive amounts of data to store. That crashes and they're under top of control.
Yeah. It's hard. I have right now a Seagate expansion. That's what I'm currently using. You look online and there's reviews where everybody's had a bad experience with a certain type of brand. I'm using the Seagate expansion if it matters, and it's so far so good. But again, the key is make sure your stuff is in as many places as possible. So if something fails, it's a non-event. Sorry.
Like you said, you have to go under the assumption that everything can disappear in a minute. Mm-hmm. My other assumption is like everything is hackable. How do you feel about the the apps where you can store passwords online? Is that even safe?
Well, okay. Anything online, nothing online can be 100% safe. It's just the reality. You know, I personally use a system called 1Password, and I have it synchronized via Dropbox. I feel comfortable with the company and their encryption that hopefully everything is okay. Some people would not be comfortable with that. All I would say is do it from a reputable vendor and make sure that and ask questions, you know, is this stuff encrypted? It should be, I would assume. That's a long way of saying I personally do it, but that's a choice that I make. Other people might not be comfortable with that. I'm getting the hook. I think I'm around all day, so just come find me if you have any questions at all.
Right on.
Yeah.